Hello students, I am Suman Dua from Department of Anthropology, University of Delhi, Delhi. Today, I am going to speak on the module Reproductive Health Issues and Sexually Transmitted Infections from the paper Demographic Anthropology. The learning objectives of the module are to understand the concept of reproductive health, to know about the factors affecting reproductive health, to get an understanding of the reproductive issues in India, to understand the type, scope, prevention, diagnosis, and treatment of sexually transmitted infections. Reproductive health. And inside the concept of reproductive health, coupled the integration of the right of men and women to be educated about steps for safe sex and providing them easy access to secure, effective, and reasonably priced methods of fertility guideline of their own wish, and the right of usage of apposite healthcare facilities that will help women to be safe and protected throughout pregnancy and childbirth, and provide couples with the efficient chances of having healthy infants. WHO 1988. Reproductive health, therefore, refers to the diseases, illness, and disorders which affect the functioning and performance of male and female reproductive systems throughout life. Reproductive disorders consist of birth defects, developmental disorders, low birth weight, premature birth, infertility, impotency, and menstrual dysfunctions. Sexuality and reproduction are the main facets of an individual's identity, and they are also basic to human welfare, fulfilling the relationships within diverse cultural contexts. Scope of reproductive health. The International Conference on Population Development Program of Action has identified 6 components in context to the primary healthcare associated with the reproductive health, which are family planning related to counseling, information, education, communication, and services. Education and services regarding prenatal care, safe methods of delivery, postnatal care, with special emphasis on breastfeeding practices, infant and mother's health care, prevention and apposite treatment of infertility, prevention of unsafe abortion, and proper management of the subsequent consequences of abortion, spreading awareness and providing proper treatment of reproductive tract infections, sexually transmitted diseases, and other reproductive health problems, facilitating information, education, and counseling on issues of human sexuality, reproductive health, and responsible parenthood. Factors affecting reproductive health. There is a complex of interplay of socioeconomic, environmental, and cultural factors that contribute to the reproductive health of populations, particularly women in developing countries. Poverty, ignorance, illiteracy, and malnutrition are major determinants of women's health status. Also, significant are the age at marriage and pregnancy, the number and frequency of childbearing, and the numbers of unwanted pregnancies and abortions that contribute to morbidity and mortality among women and their babies. The lower the status and the worth of women in society, the higher the maternal mortality, and not least important are the health service related factors such as lack of access to quality reproductive health services. Diet and nutrition play a vital role in maintaining the health of an individual. Deficiency of vitamin D and K is known to be contributing factor of infertility. Thus, proper nutrition helps in balancing the reproductive health of men as well as women. Several studies have also indicated that the intake of vitamin-rich diet facilitates the improvisation of sexual health and well-being. The reproductive fertility of both men and women is also affected by their body weight. Overweight and obese women experience problems in ovulation, irregular or scanty periods, polycystic ovarian syndrome, and abnormalities in insulin response, and have imbalance in estrogen levels. Women who are underweight may also have problems in ovulating during their monthly menstrual cycle. A woman's age is also a significant factor which contributes to our ability to conceive. After the age of 35, there is a fall in reproduction of eggs in a woman's ovaries. Their fertility begins to decline after this age. With the quantity, the quality and longevity of the produced eggs also starts deteriorating with age. Women nearing menopause have a higher risk of producing eggs with chromosomal abnormalities, which might lead to birth defects and miscarriage. Late age of pregnancy and conception also results in offsprings having a high risk of having birth defects such as Down syndrome, Edwards syndrome, or Patau syndrome, and other chromosomal abnormalities. On the contrary, early age of a girl at the time of her marriage may affect her reproductive health adversely. The early age of childbearing have high risks of complications pertaining to because the body requires proper nutrition and strength to carry the fetus and for its overall development, which may not be possible in case of young girls being pregnant. This may lead to simultaneous induced abortions, fatigue, and even death in adverse cases. However, adolescent girls in many parts of the world are married at a very early age, and they are often at weak position to gain access to contraceptive measures or refuse sexual contact with their partners. Gender disparity limits women and girls' control over their sexual and reproductive choices and consent. This has been manifested all around the world with widespread violations of health and human rights, which include human trafficking for sexual purposes, sexual violence and coercion, practices of female genital mutilation, and an enduring pressure to get married and start bearing offspring at a very early age. These types of violations are rampant in high, middle, and low income countries, with the women in developing and underdeveloped countries being the worst sufferers. Although accessibility of safe health care facilities is a key element of all the prime organizations undertaking reproductive health and sexual health initiatives globally, each year almost 10 to 15 million women are recorded to suffer severe or chronic illnesses which have been caused by complications which occur during pregnancy or childbirth. The organizations, along with their allies at the ground level, are trying to provide proper healthcare solutions and manage complications related to pregnancy and childbirth. Apart from these biological and social factors, environment to affect the reproductive health of women. Estrogen level fluctuates when it comes in contact with chemical fertilizers, pesticides, and industrial solvents. Smoking and alcohol consumption also leads to severe reproductive problems such as damage to ovaries, alterations in menstrual cycle, early menopause, and reduction in production of fertilized eggs. Stress is another factor, if severe enough, can halt menstruation. Reproductive health indicators for global monitoring are total fertility rate. TFR is defined as the total number of children a woman will have by the end of her reproductive period, provided she qualifies the prevailing age-specific rate of fertility throughout the phase of childbearing. TFR is one of the most extensively used fertility measures to gauge and assess effectiveness of the family planning programs. This measure remains unaffected by the age structure of the female population. Contraceptive prevalence. This indicator estimates the percentage of women belonging to the reproductive age who are using or if their partner is using any kind of contraceptive method at a particular point of time. Maternal mortality ratio. MMR is calculated as the number of maternal deaths per 100,000 live births which are caused due to complications with pregnancy and childbirth. Antenatal care coverage. This indicator measures the percentage of women who have been attended by skilled healthcare personnel at least once during pregnancy or reasons relating to pregnancy. Births attended by skilled health personnel, it computes the percentage of births which are attended and facilitated by skilled health personnel. This measure does not account for deliveries assessed by traditional birth attendants. Availability of basic essential obstetric care. It measures the number of services with operational basic essential obstetric care for every 500,000 individuals in a population. Essential obstetric care includes parenteral antibiotics, oxytocin drugs, sedatives for eclampsia, removal of placenta manually, and assisted vaginal delivery. These services are provided at the health center level by trained attendants. Availability of comprehensive essential obstetric care. This indicator assesses the number of facilities with an operational wide-ranging essential obstetric care per 500,000 individuals in a population. It integrates obstetric surgery, anesthesia, and blood transfusion facilities along with the basic obstetric care services. Perinatal mortality rate. It measures the number of perinatal deaths per 1,000 total births. Prenatal deaths include deaths occurring due to late pregnancy, childbirth, up to 7 completed days of life, which is the period from 22 weeks of gestation till the end of the first week after the birth of the child. Total birth means a sum of live birth and IUFD born subsequent to the fetus reaching the stage of viability. Low birth weight prevalence. This measures the percentage of occurrence of live births who weigh less than 2.5 kg. Positive syphilis serology prevalence in pregnant women. It is the percentage of pregnant women aged 15 to 24 whose blood sample screened for syphilis showed positive serology for it attending the antenatal clinics. Prevalence of anemia in women. It is referred to as the percentage of women of reproductive age, that is 15 to 49, who have been screened for hemoglobin levels for anemia. The levels below 110 grams per liter for pregnant women and below 120 grams per liter for non-pregnant women are included in this percentage. Percentage of obstetric and gynecological admissions owing to abortion. Percentage of all cases admitted to the service delivery points facilitating the inpatient obstetric and gynecological facilities which have occurred due to abortion. These include cases of spontaneous and induced abortions but not the planned termination of pregnancy. Reported prevalence of women with female genital mutilation. This reports the percentage of women who have reportedly undergone female genital mutilation. The percentage is calculated on the basis of their responses to the interviews conducted in a community service. Prevalence of infertility in women. This indicator computes the percentage of women aged 15 to 49 years who have been reportedly trying to get pregnant for 2 years or more but are unable to conceive. Reported incidence of urethritis in men. This estimates the percentage of women in their reproductive phase interviewed in a community survey reported to have at least one episode of urethritis in the past 1 year. HIV prevalence in pregnant women. It is the percentage of pregnant women aged 15 and 24 taking medical assistance from antenatal clinics whose blood was screened to be positive for HIV. Knowledge of HIV-related prevention practices. It is calculated the total percentage of all respondents who were able to correctly figure out all three main ways of preventing sexual transmission of HIV and also those who rejected three chief misconceptions related to HIV transmission or prevention. Sexually transmitted diseases. Diseases which spread through unsafe sexual contact are referred to as sexually transmitted diseases. In recent years, many experts of public health have suggested on replacing STD with sexually transmitted infection or STI. A woman's anatomy makes her more vulnerable to sexually transmitted infections than a man because a woman's vagina provides a warm and moist environment which encourages the growth of bacteria, mucous membrane which covers the area allow easy access and breeding ground for viruses which may lead to infections. More than 30 different kinds of bacteria, viruses and parasites have been known to be get transmitted through sexual contact. 8 types of sexually transmitted diseases are having a higher incidence rate, out of which 4 are curable, such as syphilis, gonorrhea, chlamydia, and trichomoniasis. The remaining 4 are caused by virus, and these viral infections are incurable till date. The viral infections are hepatitis B, herpes simplex virus, HIV, and human papillomavirus. Although these viral infections are incurable, the symptoms associated with these diseases can be reduced or can undergo modifications through proper treatment. STIs are spread predominantly by unsafe sexual contact. Some STIs can also spread via non-sexual means, such as transfusion of infected person's blood or bodily fluids to normal person, or through infected needles. Many STIs, including chlamydia, gonorrhea, primarily hepatitis B, HIV, and syphilis, can also be transmitted from infected mother to the child during pregnancy and childbirth. Generally, there are 3 different types of reproductive tract infections which have been observed in women. These are endogenous infections. Those infections are caused by the multiplication of pathogens present in the vagina. Iatrogenic infections, these are caused by the introduction of infection-causing pathogens through medical procedures like IUD insertion, sexually transmitted infections if detected at an early age and properly treated, endogenous infections, and many iatrogenic and sexually transmitted infections can be cured. However, if these are not treated or cared properly, these can lead to severe complications during pregnancy and childbirth, often resulting in congenital infections and chronic pain. Untreated long-term reproductive tract infections can also be termed as risk factor for diseases related to pelvic inflammation and HIV. Types of sexually transmitted infections: chlamydia and gonorrhea. Pelvic inflammatory disease is the infection of uterus, fallopian tubes, and other reproductive organs. PID are a result of untreated sexually transmitted infections such as chlamydia and gonorrhea. PID can have serious consequences, which may have an effect on the fertility of women, may lead to complications during pregnancy and childbirth. Genital herpes is a common disease among women. It is regarded as skin infection of genitals and may not have adverse health consequences. Once a person gets infected by the herpes, it will stay inside the body forever. However, it generally do not interfere with a woman's ability to reproduce. Although the herpes infection might have an effect on the health of the newborn baby, but it is a rare phenomenon. Human immunodeficiency syndrome virus, HIV. Before the birth of the baby, all pregnant women are recommended to get themselves tested for HIV. This is important to prevent the spread of this virus. HIV can be transmitted from a mother and child during the contact of blood during labor and later through breastfeeding. The advanced testing of HIV is expectant mother may be beneficial, as positive tested women may plan the well-being of the unborn child with the doctor in advance or may medically terminate the pregnancy if safe. Prevention of STIs, counseling and behavioral approaches. Present primary avoidance against STIs and unintended mistimed pregnancies. These include comprehensive sexuality and adult education, pre and post testing counseling for STI and HIV positive patients, counseling on adopting safer sex practices, condom promotion, and interventions focusing on vulnerable population groups such as sex workers, those who involve in sexual activities with the same sex, person and people who inject drugs. Counseling can help in improvisation of a person's ability to observe the symptoms of STIs and understand the possible type, resulting in the increase in the care-seeking behavior. Unfortunately, lack of awareness among the masses, shortage of trained health workers, and a widespread stigma attached to STIs has always been a barrier to greater and much more effective utilization of these interventions. Now we come to the barrier methods. The correct and consistent use of condoms is regarded as one of the most efficient methods for protection against STI, which include HIV as well. Female condoms are also useful and safe, although they are not widely used in comparison to male ones. Diagnosis of STIs. Accurate diagnostic tests for diagnosis of STIs are extensively used in developed countries. These are particularly useful in case of diagnosis of infections without visible symptoms or signs. On the other hand, these diagnostic tests are unavailable or used very rarely in developing and underdeveloped countries. These tests are very expensive and available rarely in these countries, so accessibility is another issue. Patients need to wait for long to receive results from these tests, and therefore follow-up is not always possible, which can result in delayed or incomplete treatment. Rapid syphilis and HIV tests are currently available in most of the countries of the world, which provide faster results and are also cost-effective. The rapid syphilis test is widely being used in many resource-limited areas. This test is accurate and provides results within 15 to 20 minutes and requires only minimal training or testing. Rapid syphilis tests have shown an increase in the figure of pregnant women who are being tested for syphilis. However, greater efforts are required in many developing and underdeveloped countries for ensuring that all pregnant women undergo a syphilis test. Treatment of STIs. Out of 8 recognized STIs, 4 are completely curable. The curable STIs are chlamydia, gonorrhea, syphilis, and trichomoniasis. For herpes and HIV, antivirals are the most effective medications which can alter the course of the disease. For hepatitis B, immune system modulators and antiviral medications is known to help in combating against the virus and showing the damage caused by them to the liver. However, HIV, herpes and hepatitis B are still incurable. Resistance of STI, especially gonorrhea, to antibiotics has been a rapid increase in recent years, and this has resulted in reduction in treatment alternatives. The surfacing of decreased vulnerability of gonorrhea to the last line treatment preference, such as oral and injectable cephalosporins, along with antimicrobial resistance shown to macrolides, penicillins, tetracyclines, sulfonamides, quinols, makes gonorrhea a multi-drug resistance virus. Antimicrobial resistance for other STIs also exists, which make prevention and immediate treatment very critical. STI case management. Underdeveloped and developing countries rely on identifying recurring, easily recognizable symptoms for guiding treatment without depending on laboratory tests. This is known as syndromic management. This approach relies on clinical algorithms and allows health workers to diagnose specific infections by observing the visible syndromes such as abdominal pain, genital ulcers, vaginal discharge, and urethral discharge. Syndromic management is a simple, rapid, and same-day treatment, which is also inexpensive. But this intervention alternative tends to miss out infections which do not show any visible or easily observable symptoms, which is the case in majority of the STIs globally. Vaccines and other biomedical interventions. Safe and extremely effective vaccines are available for hepatitis B and HPV. These vaccines have been representative of major advances in the field of STI prevention and treatment. The vaccine against hepatitis B is a part of infant immunization program in more than 93% of countries worldwide and has been able to prevent about 1.3 million deaths from cancer and chronic liver disease. HPV vaccine is available in routine immunization program in as many as 65 countries globally, in which most of the countries are high and middle income. If 70% vaccination coverage is achieved in underdeveloped and developed countries, HPV vaccination will be able to avert the deaths of more than 4 million women in the next decade. Investigations for development of vaccines against herpes and HIV are in progress, with many vaccine candidates undergoing early clinical developmental procedures. Other biomedical interventions for prevention of some STIs also include adult male circumcision, use of microbicides. Male circumcision has been known to reduce the risk of HIV infection among men, which is acquired heterosexually by approximately 60%. It also gives some against herpes and HPV. Tenofovir gel is a type of vaginal microbicide which is observed to be having mixed results in terms of its ability to avoid HIV acquisition. However, it is effective against HSV2. Let us summarize. The factors affecting reproductive health of individuals can be broadly categorized into factors such as gender disparity and violence against women, diet, nutrition, body weight, age at conception and pregnancy, education, and income status. There are around 17 reproductive health indicators for global monitoring, which gives an insight of the status of reproductive and sexual health at a world level. Sexually transmitted diseases are those which spread through unsafe sexual contact between the infected and the uninfected individuals, and also through non-sexual means, which include transfusion of infected body fluids into an uninfected person. Few STIs can be transmitted from pregnant women to the child during the phase of pregnancy. Endogenous, iatrogenic, and sexually transmitted infections are three types of RTIs which may infect women around the world. Few STIs can be cured and treated if detected at an early age. However, few are non-curable. Prevention of STIs can be achieved through counseling and behavioral interventions by providing comprehensive sex education, counseling for safe sex, and risk reduction. And also, in case a person has been detected with STI, instead of secluding them and stigmatizing them, a pre- and post-test counseling session must be organized for them. Thank you.